My name is Steve Hayes, and I'm the ministerial assistant here at Unity Boulder. And Jack is at home resting. It's a good spiritual practice that when your body says, oh, I need to rest, then we listen to it. So it is a good morning, but let me also say happy October. Whoa, time flies. But no one can argue that it's not fall anymore, right? But the question is, are each of us taking the time to align ourselves with that energy of the fall? Are we thinking of what habits and what thoughts do I have that I need to let go, just like the leaves on a tree let go what no longer serves them? Are we spending the time in nature to soak in that energy and then bring it into our own lives? Another example of nature was that I drove here this morning at 6:30, and just the right time to see Spirit paint the sky. I live out in the east part of Boulder, and it started off right at 6:30 with these like almost purples, big broad strokes across the sky, which was spectacular enough. But then after like a few miles, I looked back and all the purple was gone. It was just this one pink wash. Oh. So I'm so appreciative that we have nature to help us ground ourselves and inspire us. I am going to start with the daily word. And there, for anyone who is a smartphone user, there's an app called Be Unity. And I highly recommend it because it displays the daily word if you have that. And it has built-in meditations. And it also has a whole way you can just type in a prayer request. So I'm reading from that today. October 1st, the daily word is prosperity. Practicing gratitude deepens my experience of prosperity. My life may be full of blessings, my family and friends, my home, my memories and experiences, but it can be easy to take it for granted if I focus more on what I'm missing rather than what I have. Being thankful, expressing my gratitude for my good, opens my heart, but it also opens my eyes to the many ways I am prosperous. I count my blessings, pausing to give thanks for each one. The more often I do this, the more feelings of gratitude will fill my heart, crowding out constricting feelings of scarcity, fear, or envy. From the serenity I feel in my heart to the peace that calms my mind, I am prosperous. As I greet each day with a prayer of thanks, my blessings abound. And the Bible quote that this is inspired by is Psalms 36:8. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. So So we don't have the bulls this morning, but I'm going to play a song which I believe is definitely inspired by Spirit. So after that song, I'll go into my talk, and then there'll be another song as a form of meditation, a little guided meditation, and then we will end with at least 10 minutes of silent meditation. So in this song that I'm about to play, I encourage you to imagine Spirit flowing through your body and bringing light and energy to whatever needs light and energy, and pushing out any of those constricting thoughts of scarcity or fear or envy. Let's see if I can do that from here. Just relax in your chair, breathe. that song is illumination. So in the daily word, it talked about a river of delight. And there's that constant flow of illumination. They're always available to us if we just turn and listen. All right. So the title of today is The Sacred Decision. And the decision I'm talking about occurred back in 1232 by the great Saint Julian. When he was on it, no, I'm joking. Unity is very much about the here and now, and what can we do that works in our lives right now, practical. So I'm not talking about anything that happened in the past. I am talking about the sacred decision that you and I could make at any moment and how powerful that can be, because unity is all about making spirit accessible, practical, and empowering. So hold me to this. At the end of this talk, ask yourself, do I have a practical takeaway from this experience? And let me know after the service. The title was inspired by this quote from The Course in Miracles. Spirit's blessing shines upon me from within my heart, where Spirit abides. I need but turn to Spirit, and every sorrow melts away as I accept Spirit's boundless love for me. I need but turn. I don't need to study for 10 years or be a guru or find the right school or even the right church. I need but turn to my heart, and there is the love of Spirit that can melt away every sorrow. Spirit's boundless love for me is in my heart. There it is. So yes, this talk that I'm giving is related to my talk a few months ago where I said that enlightenment was a piece of cake. So I'll be kind of riffing on that today. Because I realized one thing that I forgot to say about enlightenment being a piece of cake is that we have to bake that cake. No one's going to give it to us. I mean, I think God gives us the recipe, gives us all the ingredients, all the energy we need, but you can lead a horse to water, but the horse has to drink. So we have to take responsibility for our lives. This is our task, our responsibility. And to get those ingredients and to get that recipe and that energy, again, we can make that decision and tap into the love in our hearts. And I'm no cook, I'll just say that. So I can only carry this cooking metaphor so far. But I've cooked enough to know that if you have a recipe and you put just one wrong ingredient in it, the whole cake can just fall flat. So if we have a cake of enlightenment, what's the one ingredient that could make that cake just fall flat? Judgment. Condemnation. I'm not talking about discernment, because that's a divine process. I'm talking about not as good, you know, bad, less than, should, you know, all these things that are proclaiming that the world is not spirit. Just one little ingredient into your enlightenment cake, and it flattens out. I had my conscious communication practice group this last Sunday, and for a long while there, I'd only get like two or three people. But I think people are coming out of COVID now, and they're like, wow, I really want a peaceful world. You know, I don't want to be a world that's so caught up in fear and hatred. And so now I'm getting lots of people. I think this Sunday I had 11 people, which is awesome. And in that group, we're practicing how to speak without judgment. Because it's not a matter of suppressing judgment. It's learning that there's another line. Anything that's happening in your life, anything you're trying to address, even things that are way out of alignment to your values, can be addressed without judgment. In fact, that is the most effective way to address those things. So I told people in this class that our task as peacemakers is to cut judgment out, the condemnation part of judgment out, completely out of our lives, 100%. We don't reserve, you know, judgment for the real extreme cases like, you know, shootings or that the person that keeps cutting you off every morning on driving to work. No, we need to cut all judgment out. The degree that you use judgment in your life is a direct proportion of how much of that river of spirit that you are cutting off from your life. So I think it's possible. It is absolutely possible. But I had one of my participants raise their hand and say, come on, Steve, be realistic. You are asking for enlightenment. I mean, give me 100 years and I'll be there. Well, first, I love when people are authentic, you know, and speak their truth. So I was so grateful for this student asking me that. But in my mind, one of my go-to quotes is from Matthew, chapter 9, verse 9. According to your faith, let it be done to you. So if you think it's impossible and you think enlightenment will take 100 years, amen. Mark your calendar for 100 years from now and you'll you can do that. But I told her that we're not about getting to this place of enlightenment and this long journey that we have to go on. No, that cake, that enlightenment, is the sacred decision that we can do in this very moment. All we need to do is practice that sacred decision. We don't have to be concerned about how long it's going to take to get to a point where we do it all the time. All we need to do is do what I call the sacred decision. And what do I mean, really, by the sacred decision? I'm going to try to keep it really simple. When we are caught in fear or doubt, then this is the sacred decision. We stop. We breathe. We center in our hearts. That place that we connect to that river of wisdom, that place that has that boundless love, and then we choose love. Stop. Wow, I am so caught up in anger at this point, or I have no idea what I'm supposed to do here. In my heart, and then choose love. Those simple steps. Just the act of stopping and breathing, it changes your whole entire body in seconds. There's science behind it. The stopping and the breathing and even more centering in your heart switches you out of fight or flight and connects you into that parasympathetic nervous system process, which can allow that spirit to flow through you. Stop, breathe, center, and choose love. And in that centering, it could be silence, or you could be at, that could be the prayer right there. God, I'm feeling weak, and I so want to just yell at this person because they're doing something I really don't like. Give me the strength, give me the peace. And also in that centering, we may need to grieve. Spirituality is not about suppressing our feelings. It's about being true to ourselves, being true to spirit. So if you find yourself condemning yourself for something like, oh, it was such a stupid decision, stop, breathe, center in your heart, and allow yourself to feel sad. Get that flowing out of your system. And then ask, okay, God, I need peace in this moment. I need healing in this moment. And the love part is, whatever I'm going to say in this moment now, I just centered, I've asked for support. Now, what am I going to say? Is there any judgment in it? If there is, I'm going to switch and do what I can to speak the language of love, which is just about addressing whatever needs to be done. No wrong and right. What needs to be done in this moment to honor everyone involved. Yeah, I think love is always the answer. And I don't think that's a fluffy thing. I think it's a way of thinking that if you adopt it in your life, it will transform your life. I use this Insight Timer app on my phone, and everyone has a tagline, and mine is love is the content, because everyone's always trying to love themselves or the other or the world. The content, the question, and the answer, all across the board. So I'm hoping right now that you will hear that and give it a chance. Otherwise, 10 years from now, you'd be like, oh, I get it now. Gosh, why didn't I listen to Steve like 10 years ago? Because he said love was the answer. So don't do it 10 years from now. Give it a shot right now and try it out. But enlightenment is a decision to rely on light in the here and now. You have to give up any sense of what I call endarkment. Like, oh, I'm going to fix this by just putting some darkness on there. Enlightenment is not a state. It's a decision, really, a decision we can make any moment. A quick example, I'm trying to think of an example that might, an anger example that won't actually make people too angry. But I met someone who was really upset about how, I guess, Boulder passed sugar tax. And they owned a business, and they're like, what is Boulder? You know, they're hippie, whatever. And what if that moment, you know, rather than cutting yourself off from having any ability to affect that, she stopped, breathed, and centered, and wow, it's going to affect my business, and I feel sad about that. But it's here, and I can accept it, and what can I do to love myself in the midst of this situation? Is it speaking to my city council members? Is it changing how I do my business? Thank you, Spirit, for guiding me in this moment and choosing to come from a place of love rather than condemnation. Yeah, we really have to get rid of this notion that enlightenment is this big journey. Like, I'm coming to church and I'm going to do that for 20 years and then, you know, whatever. Or I'm not going to do it because it takes 20 years. I could just imagine a student going to Harvard. You know, he's got this real privilege. He's going to Harvard and he gets there and the first thing he says, I want to graduate. Can I skip right to the graduation? I think the whole point of coming to Harvard is to actually learn, not to graduate. Well, that's us. We're in a school. Let's not worry about enlightenment. Let's focus on the here and now so that we, when we do get to that point, we have learned how to love. The sooner we learn how to love, the more beautiful and powerful our lives are. So let go of the future, let go of the past, be in the moment, and learn to make that sacred decision. Because remember, we have all the answers in us. I mean, Spirit is like the best college you could go to. I love how Marianne Williamson from, in relation to the Course in Miracles, says, everything that you experience in life, everything is either the perfect expression of love or the perfect lesson to learn love. Just those two things. There's no third category of just crap. There's just the expression of love and the perfect lesson. So when something comes up, okay, Spirit, thank you for showing me what I need to learn and teach me love in this moment. Because remember, we have the best teacher available 24/7, 365 days a year. Unity is principle number one. God is good everywhere, present in all things. So no matter what's happening in your life or where you are, you can tap into that, your heart, and receive that guidance, that energy, and that direction of how to show up with love. And it is so close. You know, a lot of people talk about, spirit is closer than your breath, which is pretty darn close. It can't get much closer than your breath. But then there's a quote. I think I might have it in here. Yes, Psalm 139. David asks, where can I go from your spirit? Where can, he's speaking to God or spirit, where can I flee from your presence? And basically, nowhere. This implies that the spirit is everywhere and cannot be escaped, and that he is closer. He, she, spirit is closer than any distance we can imagine. Closer than any distance than we can imagine. Even closer than our breath. Or how about in our hearts? Zero distance, because it's in our hearts. Look at that. I always like to emphasize things. Closer than any distance we can imagine. If you stop and breathe and center. Yeah, life is a school. I think of when I went to college for the second time. I pretty much dropped out of college. It wasn't a good thing when I first went to college. I wasn't really serious. And I went back second time, and I was there to learn. I wasn't thinking about getting out, just doing my homework and getting back to the fun. I was like, I'm here to learn. And I so enjoyed it. I went to a community college, and the education level was so much higher than the state schools, which is really sad. Anyway, at some point, I got a phone call, because this is before emails, saying, Steve, come in and meet a counselor. And I'm like, oh, that's interesting. And he basically said, Steve, you need to get out. Because I had so many units. I was community college, and I was able to transfer to Santa Cruz. But I had lots of units. I went there for 4 years, and 3 years I was on the sports teams and just had the time of my life. And they basically kicked me out. But I was so present and so enjoying myself that even though I got kind of kicked out, I left originally college like a 1.8 GPA. This time I graduated with summa cum laude. I was in the moment, enjoying myself, and spirit was flowing. But when I got to Santa Cruz, I had too many units again. So every quarter at Santa Cruz, I had to write an essay like, why am I still here? Can I just use the same essay again for next quarter? No. You have to come up with a whole new reason why you're still here. So I was there for 6 quarters, and I had to write an essay about why I was still there, because I had so many units. But the point is, we're in a school. Let go of the future and the past. Trust and follow your passions. So I can't really talk about sacredness in the heart without touching base on this. Caveat, I didn't grow up with in a Catholic, so I don't know, have in depth in this, but I do love this image. And I know that a big part of the world looks to Mary more than even Jesus, that this image communicates more to them. But my understanding of the symbology of the Sacred Heart, the place that we stop and make a decision to come from, that the flames up there are on top is the intensity of Mary's devotion to Spirit and to her heart. And those roses around her heart is the grace that comes in her life, the beauty that unfolds having that focus and that intensity. And then that light is the blessings that she receives from that. Just whew, who doesn't want a heart that shines like that and has that effect on our lives? But I do notice there is a sword through there too. It's like, oh, why do they have to include that? And that's the sword because she had to live through, you know, the death of her child. And so this is not here to say that we have to suffer. Again, Spirit in no way wants us to suffer. And we don't need to suffer to get enlightenment. That is a really common meme or paradigm out there. I go to different discussion groups, and a lot of them are like, yes, we need to, you know, hang out with our suffering so we can get there. And no, I don't think we need to do that. But we do need to grieve when we have those experiences. And we do need to face discomfort in our lives. If we're trying to change and grow, the only way you change and grow is if you face the discomfort. Go out there in the dance floor and step on some toes. Or don't go out on the dance floor at all. We need to face that discomfort. And she lived through that. I mean, Spirit does say that our capacity for joy can be in direct proportion in our capacity to grieve and to be with whatever's happening in our lives. So very powerful image. So we're here to learn, and that does mean we'll have trials and tribulations, but those are, again, the perfect lessons. And there's no third category of just crap. Although when I went to school, there was something called organic chemistry. That was a third category. That's pretty much why I dropped out of college first, I think, because I just couldn't handle organic chemistry. It was a lesson that I guess I wasn't willing to learn at that time. So when we say, stop, breathe, center, we are saying, you're allowing ourselves to feel our emotions. And that process has nothing to do with suppression. It has to do with turning to our heart and relying on Spirit rather than the ego. It's not easy to often grieve or to face our shadow, but that is part of the learning process. I'm so grateful that Unity believes in truth, that there's angels on the earth, whether it's Buddha, Gandhi, Martin Luther King, you know, Jack and Santisha. I mean, everyone can be an angel to us, and truth can show up in any way. That we don't have, none of us has, you know, the perfect and the only angle to Spirit. So I'm going to show you a teacher that you probably have never heard in a spiritual context, but is a great inspiration for me. So, hold back your disbelief. John Cleese. I grew up on, he's a comedian, I grew up on him and his TV shows. I've actually heard him speak, and people don't know that he's like really intelligent, and he's got multiple graduate degrees, and he's just so on point. And he's doing a tour across the United States, but doesn't come through Colorado, but I'm gonna fly out and see him. But in particular, there was a video I saw on YouTube where someone asked him, like, you know, where do you get all your ideas, you know? And then he said, the key to creativity is your willingness to sit with the discomfort. Like, he had all these team members, and they would, you know, get together and come up with a skit, all of them. And he noticed in the beginning that his teammates, like, okay, you have to do something funny about shopping for cheese, you know? And his teammates would just go, oh, that's funny, and then they would go do it. And he's like, wait, let's hold this. You know, let's not just settle for what comes. Let's stay in that, you know, oh, that little uncomfortable space of trying to come up with another idea. And if we do, then the creativity comes. That is such a spiritual lesson. You know, if we just grab whatever stops the fear, whatever cuts off, you know, the pain or the suffering, you know, the grieving, you know, quick jump to the TV or quick jump to the alcohol or whatever it is, then we're not going to fully get the lessons that we came here to receive. So by learning to allow ourselves to feel and process and ask for guidance and help with that process, we need to learn to accept discomfort, because that is growth, that can be change, and that can be where creativity really flows, or where Spirit really flows. So you all know that, I really like dragons. I'm not going to go into dragons right now, but my second favorite thing besides dragons is mandalas, like this. I can't show you the size of that, but this is the wall of a temple called the Alhambra in Spain. And there were people that spent their entire lives just on one wall, like they're artists, and they were paid to create mandalas like this on a wall. And it was so big and so vast that they would spend their whole life on one mandala. So if you go to Spain, make sure you go to Alhambra, because the beauty is just so intense. But I think this, for me, this not only is beautiful and I love all the order, I think this is how spirit shows up in our lives. You know, that we stop and we center and we open ourselves up, and this divine order comes into our awareness. No matter what's happening in our lives, we can open and receive that intelligence and that order that is balanced. That's available to us at any moment. So the world may be chaotic and our lives might be disjointed, but we can stop and listen and connect to that divine order. So when we meditate and when we pray, we're basically opening ourselves up to that divine order. So I took a selfie the other day. That's not me. But I love this tattoo, just to make it a little acceptable. Look at this person's tattoo. He's basically, it's like a visual affirmation. Like, look at me. In my heart is this divine love and beauty. And it's so important to me that I am drawing it on here to affirm that my heart is full of that divine energy and love. So we don't need to get a tattoo to experience that, but we can develop that awareness that we all have that divine harmony, that beauty in our hearts. I love mandalas so much that I think in mandalas. And when I do prayer, even meditation, it comes up to me. So I guess that's why I like it. But I had a friend who was struggling, and he wanted to talk about spirit in relation to vitality. Like, how could I bring more vitality in my life? And so I didn't just go, in my head. I paused, listened. But then I like to draw, like a mandala. So what I often do when I'm discerning is I put whatever I'm discerning on, healing, work, relationship, whatever's next, and then I build a mandala from it. And so before I talk to my friend, I can actually show you what came to me when I listened, when I centered and listened. So all my notes at church often look like this. And so I was thinking, wow, it's really key for vitality to have, real spiritual intimacy. And we really need to know ourselves. And vitality so depends on love and the self-compassion and the compassion for others. And again, eliminating the judgment, taking responsibility. And then there's two words there which I think in a past life I lived in New Zealand because I love the Maori language. And those are words from the Maori language, huka and kia ora. Huka is sugar, like something that's not really good for you, like eat it and it's just going to, fry you. And so I was like, if you want vitality, you need to cut out all the huka, all the bad food and people that maybe not serve you, the places that don't serve you, the activities that don't serve you. It's like there's so many things we can do. And the opposite of that is kura. Where in life are the things that resonate and fill me with joy? Where are the places? Where are the people? And so I took that and we had a whole great conversation around that. But that came to me like in the form of a mandala. But all this depends on having faith that your microphones will work. Faith that in that your heart does have everything you need, that guidance and that intelligence for whatever's happening in your life. Again, I'm not going to dive back into dragons too much, but if you remember my talk, I talked about dragons have all these powers, you know, wings and claws and scales and all that, but the real power of the dragon came from its unfettered faith in spirit. That's what gave dragons the most power. And I think of a modern day example, and that is the bee. You remember how for a long time they said they didn't know how the bee could fly because it's the weight ratio is too high. Little tiny wings and this big bee, how does that happen? Apparently, they figured it out, but for a long time, physics said bees should not be able to fly. But you know why they can fly? Because they're just like dragons. They're like, I'm here, and God is going to give me everything I want. You know, thank God for bees, right? But they're beautiful, and they're because they have faith, just like a dragon. And we can do that. There's a quote that Jack gave to me, and I want to, and for possible use today, and it's right on point. I don't think he even knew what I was talking about, actually. From the Course in Miracles. When you feel the holiness of your relationship is threatened by anything, stop instantly and offer the Holy Spirit your willingness, in spite of fear, to let him exchange this instant for the Holy One that you would rather have. He will never fail on this. Stop. Breathe and center. God, I don't know what to do here. God, I'm just, I've been angry about this for years, and I don't know how to let it go. Show me. I am willing. And if you do that, what does it say? He will never fail in this. The Course in Miracles, you know, chooses consciously to use the male stuff, but spirit will never fail to answer you when you truly center and you are willing. So, we have the answer in ourselves. We can all make that sacred decision, but I want to make something clear, though. We have the whole universe inside of us, all that cosmic intelligence, but we can't really do this alone. We are meant to do this in community. In fact, science says that nothing evolves at a certain point without some level of community. And I'm a runner, and so I always love running examples. And I think it was back, what year was this? 1954, when the first human ran under 4 miles. Can you imagine running a mile under four minutes? Oh my gosh. His name was Roger Bannister. And 1954, he broke the 4 minute mile. So there's three people there. You'd think that the person in the front would be Roger, right? Because he's winning, right? No. Roger Bannister is the man in the middle. And he did not break the 4 minute mile by himself. It was a team effort. In fact, the guy in the front is actually running faster than his capacity. He was the pace setter for Roger for like the first half mile. And after the half mile, he just stopped because he had expended himself so hard to be the pace setter for Roger. And that person in the behind came up, and then he became the pace setter for Roger the second part of the mile, and he also fell back. And in the end, yes, Roger Bannister just sprinted that last bit, and he broke it by like a half a second. But history could say, oh, look how great Roger is. You know, he broke the 4 minute. No. He did, but he didn't do it by himself. He was part of a community. And that's what enabled him to do it. So if you are wanting to have more spirit in your life and transform something in your life, reach out and get the support, get the community, participate in our classes here, connect with your friends or family, whatever you need to do to get that community support. All right. I've gone on long enough on that. I'm going to do a Jack impersonation. And I got to stand up and do it. If you get one thing out of this talk, forget everything else, you just get this one thing. That one thing is that we can make that sacred decision in any moment by stopping, breathing, centering in our heart, and choosing to respond with love. Thank you, Jack. All right, I'm going to go ahead and switch gears now and play you a song. What time is it right now? Yeah, this song is pretty upbeat, but I want you to use this song as a way to, again, invite spirit in, just to stir up and release whatever needs to be released, and to build that faith that the name of this song is The Arena. And it's inspired by Brené Brown, that the true glory and props is due to the people that go in the arena, the people that do stop and listen, the people that refuse to speak judgment and show up with love. So let's just listen to the song, and then short guided meditation, and then silent meditation after that. And Josh, I might want to cut it off short, so if I look like I'm severing my head, it's wanting to cut the song short. Ooh, let's just repeat this real quick first. Spirit's blessing shines upon me within my heart where spirit abides. I need but turn to spirit and every sorrow melts away as I accept spirit's boundless love for me. Maybe that's the sound of spirit calling us. Hello. But we've opened ourselves to spirit. Now it's dancing in our heart. Let go of any thinking. Just listen and allow spirit to flow through your being. Spirit reminds us that we have the power. And we never have to do it alone. Spirit's always with us. We can connect community. And so many times when we do stop and breathe and connect in our heart, we feel joy. We have trials, we have tribulation, but we can turn and tap in and receive. But what about this? What about that? Does it work here? We can bring that doubt to the Spirit. Okay, God, this is a good time right now. You said you're going to be here. I'm willing. I'm going to stop and breathe. Take what I receive from my heart, put it out in the world in the form of love. Father, Mother, God, Spirit, we are so grateful that we are blessed with a sacred heart, and that we can make that sacred decision any moment and connect at a zero distance level to all the wisdom, the guidance, the support, the energy that we need. Thank you, Spirit, for helping us let go of the attachments, let go of the future, let go of the past, and just be in this moment and trust that everything is either love or the perfect lesson for love. Thank you, Spirit. Thank you, angels. Thank you, ancestors. Thank you, nature. We are so surrounded by a support system that we can tap into and lean into, by letting go of our ego, letting go of fear, and dropping into our heart and into the silence. Now let us take the blessings we have received from connecting within and just declare that we are all beacons of light. We are all beacons of love, and we're going to go out into the world and share this. The world will never be the same. Our lives will never be the same. Spirit, Mother Earth, God, the universe, thank you for helping each and every one of us receive our full divine inheritance and the full expression out into the world. And to this we say, Amen. What I want to do now is take an offering. This too is a moment of sacred decision. Am I going to live my life on faith? Am I going to support a community? Am I going to support a place that has the vision of being accessible and practical and accessible spirituality? So let's take our offering in our hands, whether it's financial, volunteering, love and prayer, and bless it with this word, these words. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive, because I give. Thank you, Spirit. We dedicate to these tithes and the offerings our presence, our faith, our consciousness, and our decisions to the triumph of Spirit in this world. We do not engage in fear and scarcity, but trust what we receive in our hearts, in the silence, and in Spirit. Amen. Thank you. There will be no discussion today because I had to switch hats and go back and do logistics, but please, we have refreshments and meet some people and embrace community. If you do have questions about this talk, reach out, email me, call me, come in the office. Blessings. Thank you.